Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening. My name is Maureen Price, and I will be the moderator for our presentation today. I am the leader for Fluor's Business Transformation and Innovation team. We focus on new and innovative ideas, never losing sight of the critical thinking and analysis that comes from our global team of expert engineers and designers. Our people are at the core of our success, and this webinar series is an opportunity to showcase specific expertise or to talk about new trends or code changes. As with the other webinars, this will be a technical presentation intended for managers of owner-operator companies so that they can understand the data exchange that's involved in their facilities. Our speaker will talk about ISO 15926. You might be wondering what this standard is and whether it is important. This ISO standard defines a methodology for simplified industrial usage of reference data. In short, it is a standard for data exchange for the entire plant lifecycle across the entire process industry supply chain. Our speaker today is Ono Pop. Ono is an expert in the integration of engineering data and knowledge graphs. With over 40 years of industry experience, Ono has led many successful projects within Fluor. Ono is the co-author of ISO 15926, the Data Exchange Standard for Industrial Process, which is applicable for all process plants from chemical and power plants to all upstream and downstream oil and gas facility. In his time off, Ono likes to bicycle on his speed bike, and he is a gamer on Space Sims.
Thank you, Maureen. I'm really glad to do this presentation. Good day to you, folks. This presentation is about the international standard ISO 15926. The agenda is the problems we are trying to solve, how the project started, what it is, the scope of it, and why to use the ISO 15926. Then a short explanation of the principles and how to implement it. Let's start with talking about what problem we are trying to solve. Every process plant is unique. There is different software and data structures used on every EPC project. Every EPC project requires engineering. The location causes differences, the feedstock or product or process causes differences, and there is different equipment that is cheaper or better than only former process plant of this kind. This means that there is no form or design to be taken, or just partly. The proper reuse of designs, and due to the changing nature of the software, there are different brands to use that have different data structures in their database. Process plants have a lifespan of up to 50 years. Software has a new version every 2 years. The owner-operator would like to renew the software used for operations and maintenance, or for handover with the EPC contractor. EPC contractors' project disciplines work in parallel, so each discipline starts with hypotheticals. Data is engineered, and once it has a certain status, for example, release for design, handed over to other disciplines. These other disciplines had to start engineering already, or worse, had to order long delivery items. Integration problems can be solved by using only one software brand. What better is a common data standard that the entire supply chain can use, independent of software brands. As a user of software, you don't want vendor lock-in. You want competition of software brands because that stimulates improvements. I told you about the problems the standard is trying to solve. So, how did the ISO 15926 project start? The project starts in 1992, initiated by Shell. Back then, it was called ISO 10303, Application Protocol 221. The 10303 is also called STEP. STEP is still going forwards today for the airplane and car industry. STEP was focused on products, which is proper for cars and airplanes, but not for process plants. There is a difference. The process plant is unique. There is no good product model for it. And soon, the complexity of modeling process plants was discovered from the tens of thousands of entities it takes. So, it was decided to make a generic data model. This would be able to model everything. This data model was created, and until today, there was no need to change it. The project also started to make the reference data library. This is a database of terms. A couple of dozen companies have worked on that. Fleur also invested in that. The semantic web standards were released in 2004, but it was around 2013 before the ISO 15926 team decided to take to change to these standards. This is the sequence of which the parts were released. The generic data model, the overview, and the reference data library came out first. The reference data for geometry, which is about 2D and 3D symbols, was released after that. The metadata for classes was about the attributes which are given to the classes in the reference data library. The template methodology is made to simplify the use of the generic data models. Templates are information objects that comprise in them a small data model. The web ontology language implementation takes care of using the W3C standards for data integration and data warehousing. Part 11 of ISO 15926 was implemented for the use of GELISH, that stands for Generic Engineering Language, which is an alternative way of data modeling. Part 12 was released to show how an ontology can be made, but the upcoming Part 14 will be another way of doing that. Part 13 is for doing planning on an EPC project. Part 10 is for conformance testing, used by software companies to validate if their software is compliant to the different parts of ISO 15926. Part 9 is about facades, which is the outside facing of databases, so about federations and security. It is still under construction, as well as part 14. The latest project of the cooperating process plant industry is CFOS. Those letters are pronounced like that, CFOS. The acronym stands for Capital Facilities Information Handover Spec. So it is about standardizing the handover from the EPC contractor to the owner operator. The end result is a specification which can be used as a part in the contract with the EPC contractors. The handover data is to be loaded into a relational database, and the handover itself is by means of comma-separated value files. It was started 7 years ago by Shell, BP, Chevron, software companies, and EPC contractors. But now it has 56 companies participating. It is led by IOGP. That stands for International Oil and Gas Producers. But it is not just oil and gas. Also, chemical and power companies are member. CFOS is ISO 15926 compliant for its reference data library. Fleur regards CFOS as a foundational building block for our clients, one we build upon into the future ourselves. The CFOS participation has grown to 56 companies across multiple industry sectors, with 268 individual persons in the membership. On this slide are the current involved companies listed in chronological order of taking membership. These companies are paying a fee. In 2019, the first release of CFOS was out, called version 1.4. This was declared suitable to be included into the contracts with EPC companies. In the gray block, the company categories are counted. Owner-operators, EPC contractors, and software companies are well presented. but the equipment suppliers are not really there yet. I told you about the project to make the standard. Now I will explain what the ISO 15926 standard actually is. The ISO 15926 is obviously an international standard. You can use it as a neutral layer to transport data into and out of. So, like an in-between language, just like we speak English, but have different home languages. It can also be used to set up databases in this data model format. It can be used as a federation of databases. A federation means multiple databases that can be linked to each other. This can be done because the standard is using linked data. That means all data objects have an HTTP address, which you can use for the linking. The linked data concept is invented by the Semantic Web Project, which is a standard. All of this is secure, of course. Engineering needs security. The ISO 15926 is an interoperability standard. Interoperability means the ability of different types of computers, networks, operating systems, and applications to work together effectively without prior communication in order to exchange information in a useful and meaningful manner. The without prior communication part is important. It means that if somebody wants to send data to you, but the data model for the data is not settled, there is still only one way that the data can be modeled. And when you receive it, it connects to your data in the same way. The main component of the standard is a database, which has reference data as a content. Reference data are standardized terms like the words in a dictionary. Such a reference term might be the class centrifugal pump, brazed plate heat exchanger, or HTS analyzer. But also milestone, inspector, detailed engineering phase, or procurement department. And reference data can also be existing things instead of classes. The person Joe Piper, as in the responsible engineer, the city of New York, the supplier company XYZ Corp. The reference data is centrally stored. It is online in a PostgreSQL database. PostgreSQL is an association of industrial companies in Norway. There are many other associations that work with the reference data, but PostgreSQL is committed to support the library. For additions to the reference data, there is a database at data.15926.org/RDL, which is the work in progress online database. The ISO 15926 team is also making software, which will be released in the public domain on the 15926.tools website. There is a link there to the GitHub repository that will have more, so check it out. The three addresses you see on this slide, the PostgreSQL library, the work in progress database, and the tools are open to the public. When the ISO 15926 work started, Shell said that we need a data model that can withstand the changes of the times. A process plant can be running for a period up to 50 years, while software typically is changing every 2 years. For that purpose, the ISO 15926 has a generic data model. So the standard does not model pumps and pipelines, but the terms and relationships to model these by. BP said, a system of systems must interoperate through major projects and operations. This is the same solution, a generic data model. Reference data is critical, but does not deliver interoperability alone. Standard connectors are required to deliver interoperability. ISO 15926 has a modeling methodology to go with the reference data. Commercially available interoperability solutions depend on fragile, expensive, and proprietary integration. The scope of ISO 15596 is very big. All of the data lifecycle from feed, engineering, procurement, construction, and operation maintenance. So that means equipment suppliers, software companies, EPC contractors, and owner-operators. For all types of process and power plants, and upstream oil and gas. All data needed for engineering, procurement, and construction, like equipment, but also purchase orders, schedule, and milestones. Of course, the project is not going to try to boil the ocean. ISO 15596 is a methodology that can be used on software projects. The scope just doesn't rule out anything that is needed. How many reference data terms does the ISO 15926 contain? The content comprises of classes. A class is a type of something. For example, centrifugal pump is a class, but has an identifier, which has an identifier, a name, and a definition. The original PostgreSQL library had 11,000 core classes for a long time. Outside the core, another 40,000. But it was at a standstill for a while. There is a team called MRAIL, that stands for Major RDL Action Item List, now again led by PostgreSQL, expanding it. Now it has 20,000 core classes, so about 10,000 added. But it is never complete. Engineering projects will come up with new core classes that will add it. So if you do a project, you maintain your own RDL, and later you can submit new classes for addition to MRAIL. MRAIL will then propose these new classes for addition to PostgreSQL. So the PostgreSQL database is the standard RDL. PostgreSQL submits addition to ISO every few years. I told you what the standard is. Now let's talk a bit about the technical methodology, the principles of ISO 15926. You have your project data in your own database in ISO 15926 format. That data refers to the reference data classes, which are online. The reference data structure is a so-called taxonomy. The ISO 15926 formatted data is a so-called knowledge graph. The linking from items in your database to the online database is possible because each online class has its own HTTP address. That is what is called linked data. Since I showed two databases in this example, this is already a federation of databases. The taxonomy is comprised of classes. As said, a class is a type of something. In this example, an object, which I am designing, is classified as choke valve. It is called a taxonomy because the classes are connected to each other in parent-child relationships. Such a relationship is a subclass of. This is a standard semantic web relationship. In this example, you can see four classes. Artifact is superclass of choke valve. Its child is adjustable choke valve, and then multistage choke valve. The classes are standardized, they cannot be changed, which is what we require for a neutral language. But if you need a class on your project that does not exist in the standard, you can make your own reference data library taxonomy. Let's go online to check out this taxonomy. This is the online reference data library, or RDL. Its address is data.15926.org/RDL. This is not the RDL of PostgreSQL, which holds the official standardized classes, but the work-in-progress database. The data in the PostgreSQL RDL is still old. The 15926.org RDL will be moved into the PostgreSQL RDL soon. The ISO 15926 team is working on that. So I type in choke valve and press enter. A list comes up. There are more than 20,000 classes in here, more than 50,000 if you count those outside the core RDL. There are classes that have the word choke valve in their name. I click the class choke valve. The choke valve class is presented. The following can be seen. The ID is the address by which you can reach this page. You can also use this in so-called Sparkle queries. Sparkle is a kind of SQL query language for semantic web. It is an HTTP address, and that is why it is called linked data. The label is the name of the class. There is a definition. Val effective date is the date of the last change of this class object. The class is a subclass of artifact and of valve, so it has two parent classes. Then follows the list of subclasses of the choke valve. Subclasses are a specialization. The taxonomy from the last slide is used by the knowledge graph. What is a knowledge graph? Semantic web ontologies are knowledge graphs. A knowledge graph represents a collection of interlinked descriptions of entities, objects, events, or concepts. For example, such an object is a pump in my process plant, or an event can be a milestone on my project schedule. A knowledge graph puts data in context via linking and semantic metadata. For example, the pump in my process plant is in process unit 1100, which is the hydrocracker. The knowledge graphs provide a framework for data integration, unification, analytics, and sharing. By the sharing part is meant sharing between companies through linked data. So companies have knowledge graphs, which can link to the reference data of each other. For example, an EPC contractor has an engineering project, which has a specific pump in the knowledge graph, which is linked to a specific type in the RDL of a supplier. So, the project data is a knowledge graph, which is comprised of facts. There are different kinds of relationships. In this little semantic model, a centrifugal pump is shown. And the fact of this example is that the pump has an electric motor as a driver. The pump and the driver are just unnamed objects. The blue dots, the relationships give them their aspects. The references to the RDL show the terms centrifugal pump and electric motor, which are standardized classes. The red dots. Your own data is in your database, so that it is secure from the outside, which makes it suitable for project data, because engineers must secure their data from the outside. Here is another knowledge graph model to show that the pump must be hydro-tested to make sure it does not leak under a certain pressure. The hydro test pressure is 3 bar gauge, which is just a number, and the test medium is water, which is the reference data class. The relationships terms hydro test pressure bar gauge and hydro test fluid are the same as on an equipment datasheet, so not the terms that are standardized in ISO 15926. This is the level that engineers work with. This is called the design layer. Engineers will recognize these terms from their equipment data sheets. Engineers work on this layer. So this is modeled just like data sheets or instrument indexes or data like it is named on the CFOS data handover project. There is a second level, which is called the implementation layer. That level is ISO 15926 compliant. From the design layer to the instrument layer, automatic data transformation is used. So it does not require keying or manual action or mapping actions from the engineers. The implementation layer is all in 1596 compliant structures. The standard uses templates to generate the semantic web data. Templates are small sets of facts. In the semantic web language, sets are so-called triples. The implementation layer has metadata, like the data status. For example, preliminary, release for design, release for construction are data statuses. The metadata also takes care of data ownership, for example, process department, mechanical, or supplier data. There is provenance to know who created the data and what were the former values of the data. And there is a lifecycle data model, so that feed data, stands for front-end engineering and design, is separated from engineering data, supplier data, and as-built data. The lifecycle part of this is very important. It shows how data matures through the phases of the project. It shows where margins in the data are added, what the cases were that the process engineer has calculated through, what was required, and what was delivered. Most importantly, the structures are explicitly modeled. So, in our example of the pump hydro test pressure and water as a medium, the hydro test itself is a specific activity involving the pump and the water, which must have a certain pressure. Now that the activity, the pressure, and the water are all objects, it is possible to assign test data, an inspector name, etc. The big advantage is that it does not matter if the database is for the owner-operator, commissioning, or a supplier. Due to explicit modeling, all aspects can be given in every context. To summarize the differences, the knowledge graph is a network of facts, suitable for validation by engineers, who can retrieve all the data quickly, because every plant widget or activity has its full set of data links. This is modeled for the user. It is a view on the data in terms of the user's workflow. The design layer is a complete data integration. Each widget, like a pump or a pipe, has all available data, not divided up in applications. So the design layer is ideal to traverse all the data. The implementation layer is semantically complete. The data is modeled in a standard way by using the generic data model. It is consistent and well-structured. The implementation layer is explicitly modeled by the use of so-called templates, as demonstrated by the hydraulic pressure test example. This layer can be used as a data warehouse with history. It has metadata for every widget. Metadata, like data status and data ownership. Because the data in this history are complete, it enables change management. Change management is very important both to the EPC contractor and the owner-operator, as it is a basis to a good project schedule and progress measurement. The implementation layer has interoperability as it can connect to other companies that use the same standard, but may use a different model for their design layer. Finally, if you want to see how knowledge graphs and templates and lifecycle models really work, go to our website on 1596.org. Then click the topics. This website is very technical, so it explains all the ins and outs. I told you a bit about the methodology. Finally, how to implement this ISO 15926 standard. You already have data integration. Are these systems obsolete? The answer to that is no. These systems are as useful as always. ISO 15926 is not intended to replace any system. It is used for data management, to act as a go-between, a neutral layer in an ISO standard format, something you interface to and from. Sometimes commercial systems only handle part of the data you want to have integrated. ISO 15926 can also be the central repository to which systems upload and download from. Where is ISO 15926 used? Almost all websites of engineering software suppliers mention they are based on ISO 15926. ISO 15926 is usually the basis of class libraries in engineering software or used in interface mappings. Just Google your favorite engineering software brand and 15926 and you will see. An implementation project example is Dexpy. The Dexpy project is a cooperation of mainly chemical companies. Dexpy stands for Data Exchange in the Process Industry. They focus on intelligent process and instrument diagrams. This project is up to date. They did a complete harmonization with the contemporary reference data library. They have made interfaces with several intelligent process and instrument diagrams, PIDs. The classes that they have defined for use on the PIND have been harmonized with ISO 15926. An implementation project example is CIFOS, which was already mentioned. It is led by the IOGP. The project is about the handover of project data from the EPC contractor to the owner-operator. The classes in the reference data library are all in the ISO 15926 reference data library. ISO 15926, as a standard, can facilitate the streamlining of document-based information from various EPC contractors and others in the supply chain for the client. After all, the client receives so much information from which they need a filter for what they really need. Isn't ISO 15926 too complex? This is a question sometimes asked. Engineering is complex and basing of a generic data model is complex, but it is required if you want to make data models that you can use by all company in the supply chain. It has become more mature and every step held simplifications too. It is less complex now. You should look at the methodology only if you are a programmer or a modeler. Engineers and super users, they have software to deal with that. How is Fluor involved? We have been in the ISO 15926 teams from the start. Fluor has spent many work hours on creating the reference data library and the methodology. Employees of Fluor have been author of several parts of ISO 15926. Fluor has been and is today manager of several ISO 15926 projects. Fluor is very active in CIFOS, which is 100% compliant with ISO 15926. Fluor is looking into extending ISO 15926 with unstructured data. An example of unstructured data are the documents from suppliers. Those contain data that could have been checked by a computer, but because it is only in documents, has to be read manually. So this is very important for the future of EPC contracting. Fluor is creating semantic search software for unstructured data. There must be a coupling with ISDD datasheets, CIFOS and the ISO 15926. ISDD stands for Industry Standard Datasheet Definition. It is a project of MIMOSA. MIMOSA is a standardization association making asset management standards for process plants. They produce data sets for equipment datasheets. Requirements in datasheets must be compared to supplier data. Due to the completeness of ISO 15926, it includes lifecycle data, for example. It is a great enabler for digital twin, which the client can use for operations of its facilities. ISO 15926 is a good way of storing design data from different projects and clients, if they approve that. Such a storage is passed in past projects is a basis for design reuse. Design reuse is also a big benefit to our clients. In conclusion, ISO 1596 gives benefit to our clients. The capital cost can be reduced in multiple EPC contractors if multiple EPC contractors and others in the supply chain can be more seamlessly exchange information. The ISO 1596 and the standard enables that. As said, it is a great enabler for digital twin. This because the data is so complete. ISO 1596 as a standard can facilitate the streamlining of document-based information from various EPC contractors and others in the supply chain for the client. How can you start? If you want to start, one way is to do a small proof of concept. Take a pump or a control valve or a pipe and model it all through. Make interfaces with your engineering software to see how the data flows. There is open source software, but there are also companies who are specialized in ISO 1596 specifically and in CIFOS and knowledge graphs. Another idea is to participate with CIFOS. If you want advice, maybe on IT architecture or a workshop, Fleur can help. There are no strings attached. I have told you about what ISO 1596 is, the principles and the ways to implement it. I will give you back to our moderator.
Thank you, Anno. We've got a number of questions that have come in already, and I see more coming in as I speak. So let's get started. Okay, the first question. How can we use ISO 15926 if we also use classes that deviate from the ISO 15926 definition?
Yeah, this is very common, actually. For example, the CIFOS project is an excellent example of that. They have made classes that are not directly the same as in ISO 15926, but still they are 100% compliant. So what you do is you have your classes and you link those to the ISO 15926 through this linked data principle. So you make yours, your class, a subclass of a class in the ISO 15926. So then it is coupled and you say, okay, this class is actually the same or specialization of the class in the RDL. So CIFOS is doing that. Fleur is doing that. We have our own standard. Other EPC contractors are doing that. And this is the way how you can do data exchange.
All right. Great explanation. Here's another question. There is a big discrepancy in the number of classes in PCA standard and in CIFOS standard. How should we bridge this?
Yeah, so CIFOS has, I think, about 1,000 classes, not counting the properties, of course, and the lookup values. And ISO 1596 has, the work in progress database, 22,000 classes maybe. So this is your difference that you are talking about. Well, do you want to have the big ISO 1596? No, you don't. ISO 1596 is so big because it is a standard, and a standard needs to be complete. The CIFOS is about, okay, what does an owner operator want to see in data handover? And that is great because this is the first time that EPC contractors get a specification from the owner operators what needs to be data in a data handover. Until now, we just got the statement, give us everything, and we just supplied a number of boxes. But now they say exactly what they want to see and how to couple it, and the ISO 15926 is complete, so you can couple it to that and use it for your data exchange methodologies. So you don't want to make CIFOS more and bigger and more complete. That's what you don't want. You want to have it tailor-made for your business case. And it goes for everything. You have to do what your business case dictates, not the big and the great and the boiling the ocean stuff.
Exactly. Definitely. We want to keep it simple as we can. Okay, here's another question, and they keep coming in, so I hope you're ready. With a large number of classes available, how do we prevent two different engineers who choose slightly different classes for the same type of equipment?
Yeah, so we try to avoid it, of course. But it can be the case. Now, what you do is you couple it to the ISO 9026, and there it is not slightly different. So you have your opinions between engineers. I mean, if you put engineers in a room, you have if you put 100 in a room, you have 100 opinions. So what you do is you make that mapping to the clauses that are standard, and then it becomes for the computer easy to see, okay, this is the name of a class, this is a synonym for that name, and so on, and that works.
All right, great, thank you. Here's another question. Do you foresee that the use of ISO 15926 will enable or encourage reuse of plant design data?
Yeah, that is the thing that we are looking for as EPC contractors. Obviously, we are using reusing designs. That is what engineers do, right? They make a copy, they put it in their desk. And on the next project, they take the paper out of their desk because that is what they did on the last project. So that is how we can do it on this project. So design reuse is old as Abraham. But what we want is to be able to do the design reuse, not what your engineer's experience is, but the design reuse from all other projects that we have. Fluor has, for example, Fluor has hundreds of projects. And so many clients. So what we are looking for is, if we have interesting designs, we can store that. But of course, you cannot use it when another project is doing totally different data models and data structures and did it in their own way. Then it is unusable on your project. And that is what's great with standards. So if you start to use that standard, and we are starting to use it, it will be available. The design reuse will be available more and more. Another aspect of that is that you can now have hotspots of specialisms. So the designs of a certain piece of plant, a certain type, can come to a central spot. And because the data is modeled the same way, it can be used and by those specialists and sent back. So it will be possible to be much more efficient that way. With a higher specialism and more experience in one spot, not dependent on projects.
All right, that's a great summary. Okay, here's a question. Are the implementation templates defined yet? And if yes, where can we find these?
Yes, they are, all of them. So we are having a set of templates. And what you do is you go to https://15926.org. That is our website. And then on the menu in the top, you click on template specs. And there they are, more than 200 base templates. And you can model everything with those base templates. All kinds of plants, all the scope that we talked about, because these templates are also based on a generic data model, so they are like generic templates. Now, what we do is, for example, if we map CVOS, because that is what we are doing at the moment, we make so-called template interface patterns or tips. Now, these tips are having the names that you see on the engineering side or in the design layer. So you have a tip called maximum design pressure, and a tip called material of construction. And these map then automatically to those base templates. So I said before that this 1596.org site is very technical. And so as an engineer, you should not go there. It is for programmers, it is for modelers. You should not look as an engineer to base templates. You work with the tips, you work with the software, you work with your engineering terms. You recognize the term maximum design pressure much better than the name of a base template.
All right, that's a great question. I'm gonna just real quick, there's a bunch of questions in the chat about getting a recording of the presentation. It will be available on FLOR.com. It takes, I don't know, maybe 4 or 5 days, and we will notify you that that's the case. So just to maybe stop the volume of those questions, and to note that those asking questions, there's more questions coming in than Anna's gonna have time for. We will answer all of them in the Q&A document. So just so everyone knows, you're not getting ignored. Okay, next real question. What is the process for a company, an EPC contractor, an owner operator, or a software vendor to propose a change or amendment to the standard?
Yeah, so you will have changes and because I think that is the behind the question situation. You will have changes on your project. This is the thing, you make software, and on your project you need to use the software in a different way, and then you go to your in your procedure, and you go to your modeler and you say, I want to have field extra, I want to have a type of equipment extra, or a new type that we never used before, and there's a procedure and it takes weeks. And so I feel that pain behind that question. Because that is the reason that all our software dies, right? Everything that we make dies because of this reason. Now, if you use ISO 15926 and CVOS for that matter, you have your RDL on your project. You make a copy, or you have a nice federation of databases, so you link everything. So you have your stuff. Now, if you need new property, new class, stuff like that, you just do it on your project. You do it right away and you have it right away, because you need to have it for your business. You need speed. Then when the dust is settled, right, of your project, you look at, okay, what of these of this stuff that we added was really useful. Well, that stuff you send to the MRail team. MRail has a ticketing system, so you go there and you do your changes, your proposals, and the MRail team looks at it, and they are very quick about it. It will be handled in a couple of days, and then it will be checked for, okay, what you have there is not really something new. It is actually a synonym of this and that. That is a possibility. Or if you have really something useful, they say, okay, good catch, thank you very much, we're going to add it. Then the MRail makes, because MRail is an industry system organization, so the MRail proposes it to PostCSER. PostCSER is a standardization organization, so PostCSER then takes it officially, and of course it is already completely formalized with the correct definitions and stuff like that. That's what MRail does. And PostCSER then puts it into the PostCSER database as a new standard. And every few months, PostCSER then proposes a new batch to ISO, and then it is added. ISO is going to set up a database called Living Lab. And there will be an RDL, a reference data library, not for ISO 14526 only, but for every standard in ISO. Because, yeah, reference data is actually the part of every standard. Every standard, every engineering standard that exists has the reference data, because they have a list of standardized terms and a list of codes, stuff like that. That's reference data. We can also call it master data. And so that is eventually what's going into the Living Lab. But this is just starting. We are in a situation of organic growth.
All right, great. I think we have time for one, maybe two more questions. How often is the RDL updated?
The work in progress database, so the under the address data.14526.org/RDL, that's the work in progress database. It is updated all the time. So we get questions, we do it right away. It is a matter of days. The PostCSER database, maybe every couple of months, they get a batch, but not just from the MRail, they get a batch from other projects as well. For example, from DEXP. And then the ISO, yeah, the ISO process is it's a glacier. It is months and months. I am project manager of a team that is updating to edition 3 of part 4, and we have a schedule of 3 years, and that is how ISO works.
All right. So I'm going to ask one more question, and you have about a minute to answer it before we can close. So can you briefly explain what is the difference between DEXP and CFOS?
Okay. CFOS, I explained a couple of times. The scope of CFOS is the handover from the EPC contractor to the client. That is just the beginning of the scope. They intend to do requirements data and data models. So the next step is going into process data model and stuff like that, requirements. They are going into the data sheets, so they are coupling to the YIP33 project of IOGP, which is about procurement documents, and that will be merged. That will be one actually, and of course the roadmap is about going into supplier data. So that is all in the future. Now DEXP, they are more on the requirement side. So not at the handover side, but on the requirement side. They are on the beginning side of an EPC project. They deal with the intelligent P&ID and all the data around that. So the equipment summary, the instrument index, the line list, everything that is in the start of a project. So they are two projects that don't bite each other. They are each other's complement.
All right. That's a great explanation of the difference. Ano, I want to thank you so much. You've spent so much time today and in preparation for the webinar, and I know that you're going to be busy over the next couple of days answering the rest of the questions that have come in. So thank you so much for that time that you've spent. I also want to say thank you to our audience for attending. You have been very engaged. It has been a pleasure being your moderator.
Thank you. You too.
We will be hosting our next webinar on Wednesday, January 27th at 10 o'clock Central, where Fluor's subject matter experts, Morgan Rodwell and Bryant Lynch, will talk about Fluor's cryogas deep dew point process. We call it DDP, which is an award-winning technology for flexible natural gas liquids recovery for rich unconventional gases. It's cost-effective, energy-efficient, and capable of achieving high product recoveries in two operating modes. DDP and its derivatives are a great fit for NGL recovery in the projects that we're seeing this decade. Please keep in touch with your FLIR contacts, follow our social media postings, or head to the Innovation Builders page on FLIR.com to register for this or other future webinars. We appreciate your attention and thank you again for dialing in today. We will send out a compiled list of the Q&As within a few days, along with the notification that the webinar recording is available for replay on FLIR.com. If you have any questions or require additional information, please email innovation.builders@FLIR.com and someone from our team will get back to you. From all of us on the Innovation Builders team, have a safe day.